والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. لا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. شكرا. ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق وأنت خير الفاتحين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah, we are again blessed to come together in this beautiful masjid. Alhamdulillah, reading the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and discussing the noble collection of Imam Nawawi. Who remembers his kunya? Abi? Abu Zakaria, Yahya. He passed away, which year? 631. So that's 800 years ago. SubhanAllah, if you just contemplate, we're discussing the collection of someone who passed away 800 years ago. So brothers and sisters, this is an encouragement for you. If you want your name to stay this long after you pass away, this is what you should do. Invest in knowledge, subhanAllah. And may Allah bless him and bless all the ulamas who collected this. Today the hadith is the hadith number 4. We are still in our series, alhamdulillah, that started by the shuyukh, and we are continuing this. The hadith number 4 is very special hadith, mashallah. It talks about, as Brother Uthman mentioned, let's talk about the qada and qadar. But we will read first the text of the hadith, and then we will we'll continue on the explanation, inshallah. In Arabic, an Abi Abdurrahman Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiyallahu anhu, qal, حدثنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو الصادق المصدوق إن أحدكم يجمع خلقه في بطن أمه 40 يوما نطفة ثم يكون علقة مثل ذلك ثم يكون مضغة مثل ذلك ثم يرسل إليه الملك فينفخ فيه الروح ويؤمر بأربع كلمات بكتب رزقه أربع كلمات رزقه وأجله وعمله وشقي أم سعيد فوالله الذي لا إله غيره إن أحدكم ليعمل بعمل أهل الجنة حتى ما يكون بينه وبينها إلا ذراع فيسبق عليه الكتاب فيعمل بعمل أهل النار فيدخلها وإن أحدكم ليعمل بعمل أهل النار حتى ما يكون بينه وبينها إلا ذراع فيسبق عليه الكتاب فيعمل بعمل أهل الجنة فيدخلها رواه البخاري ومسلم. In English, on the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, who said, "The Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, And he is the truthful and the believed." And that's his character. Narrated to us, "Verily, the creation of each one of you is brought together in his mother's womb for 40 days in the form of a drop of fluid. Then he becomes a clot of blood for a like period. Then a morsel of flesh for a like period. Then there is sent to him the angel who blows the breath of life into him and who is commanded with four matters." And this is the importance of this hadith, the four matters. To write down his sustenance, his rizq, his lifespan, his ajal, his actions, amal, and whether he will be happy or unhappy, shaqiyun aw sa'id, whether or not will he enter paradise. Then Abdullah, the hadith says, by Allah, other than whom there's no deity, verily one of you performs the actions of people of paradise until there is but an arm length between him and it, and that which has been written overtakes him, and he acts with the actions of people of the hellfire, and then he enters hellfire. And verily, again, one of you performs the actions of the people of hellfire until there is but an arm's length between him and it, and that which has been written overtakes him, and so he acts with the actions of people of paradise, and thus he enters it, he enters paradise. Rawahu Bukhari and wa Muslim and Muslim. A lot of things in this hadith, subhanallah, and it's one of the good things first to talk about the Rijal al-Hadith, the men of this hadith. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, as you know him, is very famous sahabi, radiyallahu anhu, shahida jami'a mashahid ma'a nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He has been through most of the events with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he is one of the mubashirina bil jannah, ahad al-ashara. And they say, of course, the madhab Abi Hanifa has been learned actually from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, because he's been to Kufa, Iraq, and then Iraq, he was one of the biggest scholars in Iraq, and then he made the tafsir, and he was very good with the Quran as well, mashallah. And the madhab of Abi Hanifa is on the back of his teachings in Iraq. And then and the first thing this hadith talks about is actually the creation in the womb of a mother, of all of us, huh? And here in this hadith, it didn't come only from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, so it came from different paths with different narrations. So we have a small conflict in this hadith, which is 40 yawman, 40 days. So some people from the meaning of this hadith, from the face value, it says 40 days nutfa, 40 days alaqa, then 40 days mutqa. So 40 days of a drop, 40 days of a clot, and then 40 days of a piece of meat. So that's 120 days. And then the ruh is being breathed into the fetus of the baby. And that somehow contradicts with the science, where the science says the heartbeat of the baby comes in the first 40 days or first month of the baby's creation. So here, the first thing we notice is there is another narration of this hadith where the nutfa is not mentioned. So Imam Nawawi here, he chose the narration where nutfa is mentioned, and therefore the meaning of the hadith becomes 120 days before the ruh is breathed inside on the human. But from other turuq, you know, paths of this hadith, same hadith from other sahaba, it's only 40 days where all the three stages happening. And therefore, we don't have contradiction. It could be the saying coming from this path is correct, and the saying of this is correct. That's one thing. So if anyone comes and says this is contradict science, no, it does not, because we have also other evidences of another narration of this hadith. The second thing we need to realize is the science doesn't always tell the certainty, because science has tools. And the tools of science cannot predict the ruh. As we know, ruh, Allah says in the Quran, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْرُوحِ, and they ask you about the soul. قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي, and the soul is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tells the Prophet to say that. So nobody knows exactly when the ruh actually is breathed within. So in terms, when the science says it's 40 days when the heartbeat starts, who said that if the heartbeat starts, it's definitely ruh was there? So again, the conclusion doesn't come all the time. So there's not necessary, if the heart of the baby starts to move, or the baby starts to pulse, that there was ruh. Nobody can be certain about these things, and therefore you can also use that as a saying. Unless we have the tools, unless when the day of judgment, when Allah reveals all the knowledge, we are certain of things, then we can judge. But before that, we can't. And we cannot follow signs of whatever they say, what it says. Because science can contradict itself. It can find new tools to find out things. and then it can change its stance. And therefore, science is not a fixed thing. It's something changes all the time. And again, Allah says in Surah Al-Takathur, كَلَّا لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ. عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ means the knowledge of certainty. You get close to certainty. لَتَرَوُنَّ الْجَحِيمِ. Therefore, you would see the hellfire in front of you because you believe in it. But لَتَرَوُنَّ الْجَحِيمِ ثُمَّ لَتَرَوُنَّهَا. And therefore, after you pass away and you go to the hereafter in the day of judgment, عَيْنَ الْيَقِينِ, you will find it, you will see it, the exact certainty, the hellfire. So now in the world, we know hellfire by heart. We know that it's there by the belief. We're going very close to certainty. But on the day of judgment, then the certainty will be revealed. And that's the only certainty. So you have to always be humble when it comes to knowledge. Yeah? And as again, just quickly, when Musa alayhi salam has been asked, who is the most knowledgeable person on earth? He was very confident and he said, in the story of Khidr alayhi salam in Surah Al-Kahf, he said, I am the most knowledgeable person on earth. And Allah told him, you are not. And therefore you should go on this path and find out a person, which is Khidr alayhi salam. And he revealed to him three things which he never had any understanding or knowledge of. And therefore, with knowledge, we always need to be humble. That's the first learning of this hadith, that there might be a small contradiction, but the narrations, there are different narrations of this hadith, and also science doesn't have all the answers. Okay, that's one thing. And then now we come to the four kalimat, the four things that the ruh, when Allah says the angel has to say the ruh, to breathe in the ruh in the human, there are four things which are written. Written means it has been decided in the lawh al-mahfuz before you were born, or before at the point of your creation has been decided. What are the four things? One is rizqihi, the sustenance, and therefore people shouldn't fight. You know, you shouldn't struggle this much about rizq. That's one thing, because rizq is one of the things that is being written before you were born, even before you even become a flesh moving and coming out from the womb of your mother. Ajalihi, when he will pass away. And therefore, this is another thing that people always fear and worry about the death and when they die and all of that. But these are the things which are somehow determined, but we'll explain what is the meaning behind this. And then amalihi, his action, what he will do, is written. Shaqiyun aw sa'id, and whether he will be happy or sad. And now this is the point we're coming to this hadith, and maybe one of the most focal points of this hadith, which is how to say, are we determined, or do we have the will to choose what we do? And therefore, a lot of books has been written about this, and a lot of sayings of the ulama. So first of all, one thing you need to know is, this is not something new, and you may find people bringing this question every time throughout ages, since long time ago, but this is a question that has been almost as old as a human being, you know, has been asked all the time. And the answer is very simple. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written in the Lawh al-Mahfuz and written your faith, qadr. But that doesn't mean that you don't have the will. So mashi'atullah, it's the upper layer of this. And Allah knows all your actions. Allah knows all your actions, what you will do. So even the different paths that you will take, He knows, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He's the creator of all the paths available for you. So He created the heaven and earth even before creating you. And He created all your, وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَكُمْ وَمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Allah created you and your actions. So that's a very high level of understanding. So Allah knows everything and knows all your actions that you're going to take. But within that knowledge, subhanahu wa ta'ala, gave you the power, He allowed you to do your choice, your free will. And you can choose the right of the righteous path, or you can choose the wrong path. But both of them are written, both of them are known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's only your choice that takes you to that path. So for example, rizq is written for you, but then you still need to do the action to follow that rizq. If you fail to do that action, then you will never meet that rizq. So you might have a risk today in place X, for example. If you do actions, certain actions which are written and known already to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you reach to that risk X. But if you take another path, which is takes you to risk Y, for example, that's also known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because He created also these two paths. But it was your choice to take path X or to take path Y. So if that's clear, inshallah. And that's what and now there's another point on this. So again, it goes the same about rizq, ajal, same thing, the death. So maybe today I might die of an accident on the road, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and my rizq, my ajal may end. But then I may take paths to do that. For example, I'm careless crossing the road, and this action may lead to my death. That's written in the Lawh al-Mahfuz that you might die that way. But again, your action has made it reality and you took that path. But again, there's another path. Maybe you will die at age 80 years old and you might die on your bed. And that's also written in the Qadr. And you may take that path and end up there. Okay? But also, ulama talks about a way to change the Qadr, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah. And people who don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who are not Muslim, they may not know this. Allah gave us this very strong tool to change our Qadr. What is it? Who can tell us? الدعاء نعم وفي الحديث الصحيح لا يرد القضاء إلا الدعاء سبحانه because Allah سبحانه وتعالى is the one who created all these possibilities anyway who has the power to change it only Allah سبحانه وتعالى so Allah gives you a short path ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى to change your qadr and that's why ليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر a lot of the ulama says it's one of the nights where qadr is rewritten every year And therefore you should pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that your qadr becomes something that changes, you know. So it can become from happiness, from sadness, it could be turned into happiness by just simply making dua on that night and Allah changing all the qadrs that is written for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyway, this this is what I will end inshallah with. The last section of this hadith, when starting from the qasam, the swear, huh? فَوَاللَّهِ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ غَيْرُهُ There is a dispute on this hadith that this saying, the last part of this hadith is the saying of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud or if it's the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some people say it's the saying of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. So why? He added this part to explain the qada and qadr. The qada and qadr. He says, someone of you, he will do the action of Ahlul Jannah. So he's pious, he comes and prays, makes siyam, sadaqah, everything. And the last moment of his life, he does the action of Ahlul Nar, and then he goes to hellfire. So there's two explanations of this. And ulama discussed this. They said, either he was doing that as riya, as nifaq. So it wasn't true sincerely from his heart. And Allah definitely will reveal at the end whom he was truly. And therefore he was doing amal ahlul khair, ahlul jannah. Everybody used to see him. But at the end part of his life, the last moment of his life, Allah reveals that he was not from ahlul jannah. And this is indeed and from ahlul nar. Because of what he was doing behind the back of the people. So that's one of his explanation of this. So no need to despair and say, can I pray all my life and do all good deeds all my life? And then at the last minute, when it's the end of my life, I do one action, one wrong action, and then that's it for me. I go to hellfire. No, it's not that. Allahu adl, you know, Allahu justice. You know, he doesn't waste your a'mal. He doesn't waste your actions. And everything is written. إن الله لا يظلم مثقال ذرة Allah does injustice even with one small atom, let's say, or small piece. لا يظلم مثقال ذرة عدل Allah knows everything as well. So maybe you are showing piousness, but at the back of your heart, you're showing a lot of evilness and shar. Allah knows that, so you have to be careful. And the same thing, when someone does a bad thing in front of people's eyes, everybody thinks this person is bad. And at the end of the day, Allah reveals that he was truly a good person. And this is what he has died with. He died with the good action. And he is from Ahlul Jannah. And again, that's why always be careful when you judge people, because you cannot judge the ظاهر, you cannot judge the what appears of the person. You should know what's in the heart. So that's one explanation of this part. But there's another explanation as well. So the person, because the word here says, فَيَسْبِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ. Now we're coming back to the story of the qadr. In your qadr, for example, is written that you will always do, you will be shaqi. Shaqi means there's a lot of hardship and you will be a very bad person, let's say. But you always take the right path and the right path. But one day, one moment, you lost your vigilance, let's say. It doesn't mean that it's written for you that you are a bad person or most of your qadr is bad, that you will be bad ultimately. But what it means is, are you vigilant of your actions? So you might be vigilant that, okay, something bad is coming to me, but I will avoid it. So you've been doing that all your life, avoiding the bad things. Huh? But there's one moment at the end of your life, you lost your vigilance. You lost your vigilance. And you have to be vigilant. The mu'min always vigilant, you know, of his actions. For example, you cannot say, I've been praying 100 years. Let me just take one day of rest, you know, I don't pray. Or let me take one day of going doing ma'siyah or something like that. You never know what's going to happen on that day. And it may end up, it will be the end of your life. And we know that su'ul khatima, it's very important. Husnul khatima is one of the crucial things in the Muslim's life. His life has to end in a good way. If the end is bad, most likely it's a testimony or a judgment of all his deeds before that end point. So are you vigilant? Are you comfortable of what you do all the time? No, you shouldn't be. The mu'min is always muttaqi. The mu'min always careful. Huh? And he always do the deeds that he wants. If that day he passes away, he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a good deed. Okay? So that's also another explanation of this. أهذا وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.